You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning, afternoon, evening, whenever you're watching this. Welcome back to SBS 318. Couple of administrative things. One, I want to compliment the class as a whole. On the first exam, the average was 32.80. On this exam, it was 35.86, something like that. So that's a 3-point gain, which is 6%. 35, almost 36, 37.5 is the B. By the way, if you want to be checking your grades, go on to Blackboard, and I've outlined exactly how you calculate your current grade. And do remember that my grading scale is a little different. 90% is an A, 75% is a B, 60% is a C, 50% is a D. And I do use plus or minus grades, and I do drop the curve sometimes. It's totally subjective, sorry, but it is. There's a question coming in from Amal. I have two questions, please. First, a question in the test was about the name of the person who was in the interview or so. My question is, what do we as student benefit from memorizing the names? Because I was focusing on the information in the presentation and the interview, not the names. Amal, that's a giveaway question. You have your book in front of you on the exam. That's a complete and utter barf question. In fact, I added that question to make it really easy for everybody, not really hard. And those people who got that question should have been 2 seconds, look up, flip your book to the chapter, look up the person's name, boom, you're done. So I'm sorry you didn't like the question. Number two, in the question about two girls who are studying, one from a PowerPoint and the other from papers, I answered that both will do as well. So I assume this is the way both used to study. The question did not describe their studying routine or so. I believe I got the question wrong. Please explain. That one actually was a more difficult thinking question for everybody. And the reason is that, and in fact, this goes back to your observation of you watching the video, that the it wasn't one from PowerPoint and one from papers, though. It was one from PowerPoint and one from the video, I believe. Is that right?
I think so.
I'm asking George here, who sits along the side. But the person who watched from the video, actually, I can't remember now, but one of them would be much more distracted. And so I'll go back and look at that question. You can email me and ask me that question. But again, that was a question that was a harder one because it required you to think. And what you had to do was decide which of them was the more distracting, and one was clearly more distracting. I think one was from paper and one was from PowerPoint, and the PowerPoint would be more distracting because there's more things on your computer, I believe. I have to go back and look at the exact question. Sorry about that, Amal. I'm sorry you didn't like that. Couple of reminders for you. I will be putting out a Excel spreadsheet for you probably today or tomorrow that will have a way for you to calculate exactly what you need to get on the final to get the grade you want. Or not, it's not a final exam, it's exam 3. It's the same exam, same points as all the other exams. We're in flux, and I'll explain that in a minute as to how we're going to do this. There are two more reaction papers due. Reaction paper 4, which is the one you're diligently working on, and I hope you're enjoying trying strategies to change the strategies you picked to change your phone for 3 weeks. I hope you're enjoying it and learning from it, and you need to pay really close attention to the actual assignment and what you need to send in for that assignment. Very important that you follow the assignments to the T so you can get a perfect score. If you have questions about it, you can always come in before class, 9 to 10. George and I are there in my lab, SBS B241A. We're also both of us usually in the lab on Tuesdays and Thursdays. That's Tuesdays and Thursdays for the 9 to 10. Tuesdays and Thursdays from 2:15 to 3:15. If you want to make an appointment to come in, please email both of us, and one of us will set up a time that you can come in. We'll try to accommodate. That's the best we can do. I offered this a long time ago, that we would be glad to help you with any kind of questions you had. We'll be glad to look over your reaction papers before you turn them in. I hope you take advantage of this. Fabiola asks, when will you be available today? I would like to meet with you in person. I'm having issues with the reaction paper. George, when will you be there?
June 15 to 3.
Both of us will be there. I hope you can make it 2:15 to 3. If not, email us directly, and we'll see if we can figure out another time. I can tell now that there are lots of questions that you're going to have. My recommendation is a really strong recommendation that you calculate your grade, so you make sure you know, and the spreadsheet is coming out, so you make sure that you know exactly what you need to do and then make plans to do it. It's a little late if you've already flunked both of the first two tests, but if you email us, we'll be glad to tell you and help you figure out what you need to get on the test. I'm going to put out that spreadsheet for you that will explain exactly what you need to get and how to calculate it. So please, a word to the wise. Jackie says, could you go over the answers for these questions? What is it called when a video game player later interprets an... You know what, Jackie, I can't do this. You're going to have to email these to me. I don't have the questions and the possible answers in front of me. So if you please email, just like you did before, if you just email me the questions, I'll email you the answer, and then you can ask me the questions about that. A couple of administrative... Sorry, Jackie, I'm sorry for laughing. I wasn't laughing at you, I was laughing at George. A couple of administrative things. I have not been publicizing this, but those of you who have seen me on campus or bumped into me know that I'm wearing a large boot on my left leg and walking with a cane, and have been doing so since the beginning of the semester. I have ripped, torn in half, a ligament and a tendon in my ankle, and I'm looking at surgery. The surgery right now is scheduled, lucky for you guys, May 9th, or maybe not lucky for you guys, May 9th. That's the day of the third exam. However, I'm on a waiting list to do it sooner because my wife has shoulder replacement 8 days later, and I would like to be healthy enough to help her recuperate. So you may get, and I'm really saying this so that you notice that you pay attention to your emails, you may get an email from me and an announcement saying certain lectures are canceled because I'm in surgery. I'm just forewarning you so that you'll be aware, and hopefully those few of you who watch the lecture will actually pay attention to your email. I think, George, was there anything else I was going to say? Oh, yeah, one other thing. We are working on some extra credit for you. We had anticipated getting more extra credit. George and I are working on getting you at least another extra credit. I've got the word out to psychology professors that if they have any surveys that you guys can take, we can get you some extra credit. We're doing our best to get you as much extra credit. But we'll let you know, and you have to pay attention to the emails. George's extra credit that he had for you was only 2 points, but 2 points is 2 points. And out of the 400 people, 124 did not do it. 124 did not take advantage of a literally 5-minute survey. I went over people taking advantage of the first extra credit, which was 8 points, and a whole lot of people didn't take advantage of that either. This is not rocket science. I'm wearing a science t-shirt today, as always. This is not rocket science. You should take advantage of everything, including us. We've put out the offer for you to share your reaction papers with us, come visit us. I can look at your test and how you did on the test and tell you what you need to study better. We can't do any more for you We can't take the test for you. We can't do the reaction papers for you, but we can most certainly help you with them. And I don't find that there's much of an excuse if you don't take advantage of us and then come crying that you didn't get the grade you wanted. So that's my word to the wise. We're gonna talk today about electronic aggression. If we can go to this PowerPoint. We've talked about video gaming aggression in the past, before the exam, and now we're going to talk about different kinds of aggression. The most common one is cyberbullying, and you'll read in the book, but I wanted to read you the definition because it's very important. It's both a definition of, really a definition of bullying from Olius, who's Norwegian, I believe, who's the first one to study, to do a really good study of bullying, but his definition of cyberbullying also, his definition of bullying also holds for cyberbullying. It's repeated assaults by a more powerful individual or group of less powerful individuals with the intention to cause harm or distress. It's often personal attacks. If you were in class, by the way, I would ask you if you've been cyberbullied. I'll give you my story in a few minutes. It's trolling, where people are following you and basically commenting on everything you comment on. It's intentionally wanting to distress you or provoke you. And it's done basically through online, everything online other than social media, texting or social media. A little bit more on cyberbullying. In terms of the research that's going on, they're talking now about both cyberbullying, all three, privacy evasion and dangerous contacts, and the risk to children. I'm going to talk, not in this lecture, but the next lecture, about some of the statistics on that, and you'll get a little bit more, but I wanted to sort of front load you on that. 88% of teenagers have witnessed people being mean or cruel in social networks. That's the most common place you see it, is social networks. 15% of teens have been targets of online meanness, and that's from Amanda Lenhart's work at Pew Research Group. And cyberbullying has been studied extensively, and just like everything else, the research shows that it ranges, depending upon who you study, where you study, and how honest they are, between 10% and 40%. So let's come back to me, because I want to give you an example of cyberbullying. Can we come back to me, please? Thank you. This was back in, I would say, 1998, I believe. So this was just sort of at the beginning. I was on email, of course, and there was the internet, obviously. Very different. There were no social media at that point. And I published a book. I published a book called The Mental Health Technology Bible. It was a little book designed for psychologists and psychiatrists and social workers to help them get on what I called back then the information superhighway, which is sort of funny to think of it that way. It was Al Gore's name for it all. And the book was published. It was a little book. It was very basic, and I used very basic language to help psychologists who were very non-technological back then, help them understand what kinds of things they could use, how they could use billing systems, how they could use the internet to search for information, how they could use automated testing. And I had a CD in there that had some examples and some demos of things. It wasn't intended to be a big book. I think it only sold about 50 copies or 100 copies or something. It wasn't a big thing. About, I don't know, maybe a month after the book came out, I got an email from somebody. I had no idea who this person was. His email address was, gosh, I can't remember his last name now, but something, let's just say Jones, at ac.uk, which is a generic email address of a server in the entire UK, England, Scotland, Ireland. People have been using that one forever. I had no idea how he'd gotten the book. But what he, the title of the subject was, "The Mental Health Technology Bible is a Lemon." And he went through, literally sent me an email, page by page. Page 7, this is a lie. This is not true. Page 9, what you said here is not true. Page 11, what you said here is not true. He went page by page. My problem was, I argued with him and tried to explain to him the purpose of the book was not to be completely 100% accurate, but it was to put it in language that psychologists would understand. The next thing I knew, he'd created a whole website titled "The Mental Health Technology Bible is a Lemon." And that was I started to feel very pressured and very upset, vacillating between being hurt and being angry and being anxious. And then he took and emailed to the entire Dominguez Hills campus the link for the website and said, "See what your Dr. Rosen is doing now." Then I felt devastated. Went to the president, to the provost, to all the deans, to every single faculty member, every single staff member on this campus. Thank God it was so long ago that most people have retired, have left us. But I still have colleagues who remember that website being sent out. I was cyberbullied. That is a definition of being cyberbullied. I consulted a psychologist who dealt with this kind of stuff because it was relatively new. Psychologist said, "You made two mistakes. One, you confronted him, and two, you responded to him." Said you should have ignored him because bullies like to be responded to because then they're getting at you. You tried to come from a rational point of view and explain your reasons why you wrote what you wrote. He came from the point of view of trying to hurt you and bully you and make you hurt. Now, it turns out I understand later on why he did. He was a failed author. Somehow he got a copy of the book to review. I don't know how. He'd never written anything that was published. He had a blog where he thought of himself as, you know, an authority on technology. I think he was a techno geek. He wasn't a psychologist. And he just didn't understand. But the problem was the cyber-bullied person, which is the reason I'm telling you this example, is psychologically I was devastated. I felt horrible. I had to go to a psychologist to start talking about it. I had to figure out how to deal with it. And literally, it took months of ignoring his emails. And every time an email came in and I heard that we didn't have phones back then, so I heard that ding on my computer, "You've got mail," because I think I was on AOL at the time, "Ding, you've got mail." And I literally felt my heart rush. Now, that's that cortisol probably coming in or some other chemical that's doing the same thing. And that rush, I can even feel it now, by the way. I can feel the anxiety that's creeping up from even telling you this story. That's how powerful cyberbullying is. So let's go back to the PowerPoint, and we're going to show you some videos today about cyberbullying, and we'll come back after this video. It's a short one.
Top 10 forms of cyberbullying. Cyberbullying is a worldwide problem that's growing fast. In this video, we'll take you through the top 10 forms of cyberbullying so you have the knowledge to protect your children. 1. Exclusion. Exclusion can happen in several ways. Your child might be deliberately excluded from online activities, conversations, or social media tags. Children who don't have the latest technology, such as a mobile phone, are prone to exclusion. 2. Harassment. Harassment is sustained and intentional bullying, comprised of abusive or threatening messages sent to your child or to a group. This can severely affect a child's mental well-being. 3. Outing. Outing is the act of publicly humiliating a child or group through the online posting of private or embarrassing information without consent. Even reading your child's messages on their mobile phone out loud can be considered a form of outing. 4. Cyberstalking. Cyberstalking is a dangerous form of cyberbullying in which attackers harass victims through online communications like email or social media. It also refers to adults using the internet to contact and meet young people for abusive purposes. 5. Fraping. Fraping is when someone logs into your child's social media account and impersonates them, posting inappropriate content in their name. Remember, everything rude or otherwise posted online may never be fully gone, even if deleted. 6. Fake profiles. Fake profiles can be created by someone to hide their real identity with the intention of cyberbullying your child. The cyberbully may also use someone else's email or mobile phone to harass them. 7. Dissing. Dissing is sending or posting cruel information about your child online to damage their reputation or friendships. It also includes posting damaging photos, screenshots, or videos online. 8. Trickery. Trickery involves gaining your child's trust so that secrets can be shared publicly online. A cyberbully will befriend your child, leading them into a false sense of security before sending their private information to others. 9. Trolling. Trolling means deliberately provoking a response through the use of insults on online forums and social media sites. A troll will personally attack your child, aiming to make them angry and provoke a response. 10. Catfishing. Catfishing involves stealing online identities and recreating social networking profiles for deceptive purposes. Catfishers look at your child's profile and take information to create a fake persona. This could involve using personal information, potentially damaging your child's online reputation. Please share this video with other parents.
Interesting, huh? I was just looking and realizing somebody might say I was trolled, but I think I was actually cyber-stalked. By the guy. We found the question that Amal asked, and I want to go ahead and answer that one right now because several other people have asked me that question. So two people were studying together. One was looking at the computer and looking at the PowerPoint, and the other person had printed out the PowerPoint on paper. Who was most likely to get a better grade? And the answer is the person who is on paper, because the person who's looking at it on the computer is more likely to get distracted. There's more distractions on the computer. That was the whole point of that question. So I'm sorry if you got it wrong. It's a thinking question. Thinking questions require you to take information from the class and apply them to unique settings. They're harder questions, granted. That's why my grading scale is reduced and lower, because I ask, on every test, I ask 20 of those harder thinking questions and expect that you may not do as well on them. If you have specific questions, I was looking at, or somebody was talking to me about their test, and I said, well, look to see what you answered and what the right answer was. And I guess you guys don't get to see the right answer. You only get to see what you answered and whether it was right or wrong. We get to see what you answered and what the right answer was. So if you have a specific question like Jackie's questions, please email me and I will tell you what the right answer is, and then if you have questions about why it's the right answer, we can start a dialogue. I'm happy to do that. I went through every single question on the test and we didn't mess up any questions this time. There weren't any that potentially had two possible answers. There was one question, or there was a couple questions where there's some funny characters in it. We apologize for that. I understand that's a Microsoft issue. We'll try to be much more vigilant on the next test, but I don't think it affected anybody tragically, because the questions were pretty obvious even with the funny characters in there. So anyway, if you have questions, feel free to email George or myself. I highly recommend you email both of us, and then one of us will get back to you pretty quickly, and we'll usually reply all so we know that we've covered the problem. So back to cyberbullying. So in terms of aggression, there are basic types of aggression. The one that most of us are most familiar with is the kind that happened on the playground when we were kids, and that's overt aggression, where somebody knocks into you, pushes you, threatens you. I don't know, you've never met me, you don't know how tall I am. I'm 5'5" now. I was short for my age, still short for my age. And I was picked on a lot as a little kid. I was hit, I was pushed, I was knocked over at recess, as I suspect many of you were. Relational aggression is where your relationships are aggressed on, and that's usually social exclusion, and often that happens through social media, where you find out that somebody had a party and you weren't invited. Or you're manipulated by your friends, your friends, and I use friends in air quotes, you're manipulated into doing something in the relationship you have with them. And then peer victimization is where you are the target of aggression by your peers. And just like my experience with the guy with my book being a lemon, it's a major stressor and has huge ramifications. So let's see what Frederick Rivera has to say about this. National Academy of Sciences, by the way.
Bullying is really a very common problem. It's existed for a long time. We now know that it affects up to a third of children are bullied during school, and up to 15% are bullied online in cyberbullying. So this is an enormous public health problem and something that really demands our action. We can't any longer accept it as just a fact of life for kids growing up. And so the federal government, different agencies in the federal government and private foundations commissioned us to develop a report that would give them guidance on how to move forward to prevent bullying. This report is important because we found that not only is bullying very common, but among certain group of youth, like youth that are LGBT, youth who have disabilities such as autism, or overweight youth, bullying is a very, very common problem affecting up to half, if not three quarters of those youth. We also found that bullying has very important long-term as well as short-term effects on kids, psychological effects, somatic effects, academic effects. And those effects really can affect them not only while they're in school, but for the rest of their lives. So therefore, we really put together a report that lays out a groundwork for how to combat the problem of bullying. There is a lot that we can do about bullying. We know that there are programs such as multifaceted programs for schools that do have an effect, that do decrease bullying. We also know that states have laws. We don't know, though, whether those laws are effective. There needs to be more evaluation of the effect of those laws. We do know that some policies, such as zero tolerance policies in schools, where a child who bullies is expelled or suspended, really aren't effective, and they're actually harmful to the kids who are involved. We also know that we need better data on the prevalence of bullying, not only for the overall population, but for also for high-risk groups. We also feel that the social media companies need to step up and have policies related to bullying and to implement them on their websites and to provide us data about how effective those policies are. Parents need to realize that bullying does occur. And if their child is having problems in terms of depression or missing school because they feel like they're sick, well, parents need to really inquire about whether or not they're being bullied. And they should contact their school, they should contact their pediatrician if their child is bullying to get help. Parents can also be involved with their PTAs to make sure that their school has an effective bullying prevention program in place.
So there are two very important points that I don't want you to miss in that video. One is, at the very end, he put the onus, part of the onus, on the social media companies, asking them to be more vigilant about bullying, about cyberbullying in particular. Excuse me. And that is going on as we speak. There are several laws that we'll talk about later on in the semester that are several bills that are coming around for votes somewhere in the near future that have to do with privacy and also potentially some issues about bullying in there too. But there are also a group of senators who are very eager to talk to social media companies to get them to change their policies, to get them to be more vigilant. And then the second point, and I think he spent the last 45 seconds on this, was is also a parenting issue. And parents need to be vigilant themselves. He gave several things to look for. He talked about when your kid is missing school, talked about when your kid doesn't do his work, falls behind. Those are all parenting issues, and we spent a whole lecture talking about parenting and what kind of parents are there are, the different kind, types of parenting styles, and how that those parenting styles relate to whether the parents are vigilant or not, essentially, about their kids, because bullying is dangerous. Okay, let's move on. Hopefully you read this already when you read the book for the last test, John Suler in 2004 introduced what he called toxic disinhibition, differentiating it from benign disinhibition. Benign disinhibition is where somebody is disinhibited behind the screen, but it doesn't hurt anybody. Toxic disinhibition is where you're literally trying to damage somebody else, and particularly their personal psychological makeup, their personal psyche at the moment, their self-image, their self-esteem. And it's enhanced and enabled by a lot of the things that we've talked about this semester. This sort of an anonymity or invisibility, which is really anonymity behind the screen, as well as the fact that there's nobody, the internet's the Wild West. There's nobody monitoring it. There's no rules out there. Certain things are governed by nobody. And oftentimes you can say anything you want online, which is different. I was listening on the way in today to my favorite radio show, which is Howard Stern, and he was talking about the difference between stuff that's posted on the internet, which anybody can say anything basically on the internet. I mean, you can't say you're gonna kill somebody, that will probably get taken down, potentially. But there's no governor over it. There's nobody that watches what you say on the internet. Comparing that with newspapers that are responsible for checking and double checking sources. And then in between, he was putting the television news media. And actually this was kind of a funny episode because he had jokingly said the day before he couldn't wait until his contract was done in 2020 and he was going to retire. He couldn't wait to retire. And a newspaper, somebody reported online, I think, oh, Howard Stern's retiring. And then it got into two news broadcasts reporting he was retiring. And that isn't what it was about, but they didn't have to check their sources. So one example of toxic disinhibition, which happens really often, and particularly on social media, is called flaming, which is basically being very hostile to someone through communication. Oftentimes it involves using all capital letters, using angry-looking emojis, using all sorts of tricks of textisms to help you really make somebody feel poorly. So let's look at the online disinhibition effect and let's see what they have to say.
Online disinhibition is the lack of restraint one feels when communicating online in comparison to communicating in person. Anonymity, asynchronous communication, and empathy deficit contribute to online disinhibition. Anonymity can make a person feel safe online, like a different person. One might even take on a new persona. It can also make one feel like doing or saying anything is possible because one will most likely not be reprimanded in real life. Asynchronous communication is communication that is not happening live, and it can take time for the original message to receive a response. Asynchronous communication affects online disinhibition, because one can send a message out into the internet and not get an immediate reply, and log out. Therefore, one doesn't have to think about what is said. On the other hand, this also gives one time to give a more thoughtful response. Empathy deficit is the reduction of being able to identify with others' emotions. There is an empathy deficit because of lack of nonverbal feedback. Through mediated communication, it is hard to know what tone and facial expressions accompany the message. So, it makes it harder to empathize with others. Both anonymity and empathy deficit make it harder to perceive others online as people with feelings because of the lack of facial interaction. Cyberbullying is the act of trying to make another person feel embarrassed, intimidated, or bad about themselves through the internet. Online disinhibition plays a role in the act of cyberbullying. Anonymity usually leads to meaner comments towards others, cyberbullying, but it alone doesn't cause cyberbullying. Asynchronous communication allows a bully to say what they have to say and then log out like nothing happened, having to face no consequence outside of the internet. Empathy deficit is what allows a bully to post the messages in the first place. The victim is reduced to a name on a computer screen. Racist, sexist, violent, and rude online comments aren't the direct result of anonymity. Those comments arise only when other people are also saying things like that. Online users tend to keep the same tone, civility/incivility, as others in online posts. The online disinhibition effect can have an effect on one's job security and future employment opportunities. 16-year-old Kimberly Swan was fired from her job due to negative comments she made about her occupation on her Facebook page, while another infamous case involved a woman, Heather Armstrong, being terminated after lampooning her colleagues on the internet. These are consequences of certain internet users believing themselves to be unchained from typical social strictures. The author of Six Causes of Online Disinhibition states that impaired with face-to-face interactions, online we feel freer to do and say what we want and, as a result, often do and say things we shouldn't. Online disinhibition can also have positive outcomes. People that are shy, that feel they can't talk about certain things in their real lives, that may have no vocal outlet can benefit from online disinhibition without causing harm to others. The anonymity of being online allows people to self-disclose more than they do in person. Online disinhibition can provide a safe place for people of the LGBTQ community to share information and support one another. It can help students be more interactive in online classrooms than they are in real classrooms.
I know that that voice sounded very strange, by the way, but I like that video because I think it's very complete. And just to remind you, not that you need reminding anymore, but videos are fair game for the exam too, as you know. And it's very easy to watch the video and take notes from it. Anything's fair game, as you probably should know by now. Okay, so let's move on. There's a lot of video gaming that goes on that is online. And most of the people I know who now play video games play online with a headset, and they play with an online community. Some of the people they may know, some of the people they may not know. But because there's no visual image there of the person, you're just getting their voice, it's still pretty anonymous. And so online gaming really creates conditions that promote bullying. And there's no statistics on this. I tried to look for statistics on this. There are no statistics on bullying through gaming, because it's so new. But think about it. You're playing a game that most of those games are high arousal. You're amped up. You're killing people, you're gathering things, you're looking for things, you're doing all those things you do online, you're building things. There's a lot of high arousal, there's very big sensory overload. That's what makes gaming so interesting, is it tries to hit at all your senses at the same time. There are novel situations, the gaming presents novel situations that could be lead to aggressive behavior. It's anonymous, and as I've said a zillion times, it's behind a screen, and when you're looking at a screen, you don't see the people at the other side, you only see yourself. So gaming is ripe for that. And this one's very interesting. I was not aware of this until very recently, and found this video that shows what's called swatting. So take a look. I don't even know if you're familiar with it.
It's a terrifying moment as a SWAT team bursts in. But imagine if they've been summoned by a hoaxer. It's called swatting, when someone calls 911 to report a hostage situation, sending a SWAT team racing to the scene.
There were people 5 feet away from me with guns and rifles.
It happened to Mike Stack, a conservative blogger. A SWAT team surrounded Stack's home minutes after receiving this chilling 911 call.
I killed my wife.
You killed your wife? And how did you kill her?
I shot her.
Stack showed our Lisa Guerrero how he was dragged from his home in the middle of the night.
Mike, were you afraid that you could have lost your life that night?
I believe I probably could have lost my life.
Jordan Mathewson is another swatting victim. He was playing a computer game when the SWAT team burst in after a 911 call about a massacre that turned out to be bogus. Miley Cyrus is another victim of swatting. A SWAT team surrounded her LA mansion after a phony call that she was being held hostage.
We checked the residence, there's nobody home. We believe it's a prank call.
This knucklehead actually set up a swatting channel. He made $4,000 by charging viewers to watch him call in hoaxes, like this one targeting Purdue University.
Purdue Police, can I help you?
You have until 9:35 p.m. to disarm or find the bombs.
And he swatted Florida State University Student Center, laughing after phoning in another bogus bomb scare.
Guys, look, everybody is leaving.
Ashton Lundeby served 2 years in federal juvenile detention.
I will never do anything like this again.
Now, in Wichita, Kansas, a father of two was gunned down by a police officer after a bogus 911 call, allegedly made by 25-year-old gamer Tyler Barris from his home in Los Angeles, 1,400 miles away.
Get in! Walk this way! Walk!
It's what authorities feared would happen. A swatting incident causing the tragic death of an innocent man.
Interesting, huh? It's obviously a very extreme form of aggression. And again, it can happen. And you saw the kid who did it completely anonymously. The reason he got caught is because his computer has an IP address that they could trace. But it was done completely anonymously. So that video I find very chilling every time I watch it. So what do we know about cyberbullying? There is a tremendous amount of research on cyberbullying. I wrote, co-edited with two colleagues, a book called The Psychology, Technology, and Society. And in there we had two chapters on cyberbullying talking about the ramifications, and the ramifications are pretty strong. It clearly, and again, use me as an example, it causes emotional distress, it causes in kids delinquent behavior because just bad behavior, basically. Social anxiety, reduced self-esteem. The press likes to make a big deal out of suicides according to or due to cyberbullying. There was one that was publicized heavily a few years ago that happened in Missouri. They're very, very, very rare. I sit on the fence as to whether I think it's good to publicize them or not. On some level, I think it shows the impact, the negative impact of cyberbullying pretty graphically. But I also think it leads to people believing that it happens more often and maybe even thinking that suicide's a way out. So I'm a little bit on the fence on that. And then, remember, we talked about overt versus relational victimization, but they also predict that people who are victimized will internalize, meaning the symptoms are inside of them. Anxiety, depression, stress, all of them are internal symptoms and psychological distress. So here's a video about cyberbullying that I think is a really good one. So please pay a lot of attention to this.
Thanks.
Go, Ethan. I retweeted your video.
Nice.
Hey, man.
Hey, boys.
Dude, our video's blowing up.
I know, isn't it great?
It has like 400 likes on Twitter.
Really?
Yeah. That part where he's falling on the ground is my favorite part.
Mine too.
Alright, I'll catch you later, man.
What a loser.
See the video I posted last night? It already has like over 400 likes.
We saw the video.
And?
You're a jerk. Is that what you want to hear?
I didn't ask you.
And poor Charlie Higgins didn't ask for you to humiliate him for the whole world to see either.
Whoa. Beth, Colleen, calm down. I was just the camera guy.
Just the camera guy? Didn't you edit the video?
Yeah, and post it.
Yeah.
What did he ever do to you? Oh, let me guess. He sucks at shooting foul shots. He wears glasses. He pulls his socks up too high. And oh, look at me. I'm a big basketball player. I score 25 points a game and you sit on the bench and look stupid.
Do you feel better about yourself now? How insecure do you have to be to do something like this?
He's like the nicest kid ever and you were dumb enough to post that video for the whole world to see just how dumb you are.
Whoa. Calm down, guys. Emily, help me out here.
Look, Ethan, Charlie's my friend.
Wait, really?
Yeah, I know you think this whole thing's funny, but how would you feel if somebody made a video like that about you?
Well, we were just having a little fun, that's all.
Is Charlie having fun?
You don't understand.
Was Charlie having fun? I wouldn't have taken you to be a guy to do something like that.
There he is, the big filmmaker.
Hey, what are you talking about?
You didn't see last night? We got like 1,000 likes on our Twitter video.
Really?
Yeah, man.
That's crazy.
Hey guys, look who it is. Hey, sorry coach, my mom says I got too much homework tonight. I can't come to practice. Hey! Let's quit standing around and get back to practice. Let's go! Hey man, you see our numbers already? We're like 10,000 likes right now. It's insane.
Yeah, I saw.
Dude, what's wrong with you? You're not starting to feel sorry for him, are you?
Look man, what did he ever do to us?
Dude, the kid's a loser. Come on, look at him. I mean, I've seen a lot of losers in my lifetime. That kid takes the cake. Now listen, I got another idea for a video.
What more do you want to do to him? I heard he quit the team because of us.
Yo.
Hey, Emily. I've been thinking about what you said yesterday. I never intended for things to get this out of hand. It's just supposed to be a joke, you know?
Let me guess. Your joke isn't so funny anymore.
Yeah.
It's about time.
I never thought that video was funny to begin with.
Would you two leave me alone already?
Probably not.
Yeah, not gonna happen.
So what do I do now? It's not like I can just delete the video and pretend like it never happened. Everyone will think I'm a big chump.
What do you care about more? What people think of you, or doing the right thing?
Why'd you delete it, huh? Why'd you delete it?
Dude, chill out!
We had 10,000 likes. 10,000. You just deleted them all. Gone. Just because you started feeling sorry for him?
Look, man, we never should have treated him like that. He quit the team because of us.
What'd you think was gonna happen?
I didn't know it was gonna happen. You just told me to film it.
I didn't tell you to edit it. I didn't tell you to post it. It was all your idea. Your idea. You're the one who posted it for the whole world to see, and guess what? I don't see what the big deal is.
Just because a bunch of people like the video doesn't make it right.
Hold on, man. Quit being so weak. You believe this guy?
I don't know.
Your friends are here to see you.
Who is it?
Hey, Charlie.
Oh, Mario Kart.
I love this game.
What do you want?
Look, I'm really sorry about the video. Thing just got carried away, you know? I didn't mean for all this to happen. I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. And I'd like you to consider coming back to the team. I'd be willing to explain things to Coach if it would help.
I'm not coming back. I was never good at basketball anyways.
Look, you work harder out there than anyone else does. And believe it or not, you make me work harder too. So, I think you deserve a spot on the team. And I'd be willing to stand up against anyone who disagrees with me. So, just think about it.
Thanks. Thanks for deleting the video.
Sure.
Here, let's gather up. Come on. All right, listen. What you guys did on that video was foolish and hurtful, and there will be consequences. Do I make myself clear?
Yes, Coach.
I can't hear you.
Yes, Coach.
Get on the line. Charlie.
Hey, man, there's no reason for you to run this.
Part of this team again, right?
Yeah.
Then I'm running too.
Okay, go get on the line.
All right, guys, get ready. Go!
So, obviously that was staged. It was actors playing a role. There's one thing that's a bit of a fallacy in that, and I want to point that out, that the video was posted on Twitter, and what they didn't show, which is much more prevalent, is that people then retweet the video, which means that even though he took it down, it can stay up. And they can rebrand the video, give it a different name, and it can stay forever and keep getting passed around. And so that's one of the hazards of cyberbullying, is that the internet sort of makes it much easier to bully and much easier for the bullying to spread across the city, the state, the country, the world. And there's been some pretty strong examples of that. Politically right now, we're in the middle of what I would call cyberbullying. Whenever somebody calls somebody a nickname that's derogatory, like Pocahontas, that's a form of cyberbullying. That's using a electronic platform to affect someone and to make them hurt. So when you're out there watching these things, it's important to recognize. And I think, please pay attention to what that last video said at the end of how you can help. I don't know if you noticed at the very, very end at the bottom of the screen, I think it said it came from Suicide Center Lifeline. And the reason that was put out is because some cyberbullying can lead to suicide. Not, again, like I said before, not a lot. Great test question, not a lot. But that's not the only potential damage that you can do. You definitely can damage someone's psyche. So let's move on and talk about different kinds of forms of electronic aggression. One of the most interesting ones has to do with, and we'll see a video on this too, I think we'll have time, has to do with unleashing little programs that can damage your computer, damage your files. The first one's called Internet Worms. Internet Worms are programs that basically you download by opening up a file, by clicking on a link, and a little program, and usually these programs are very tiny, a little program is put on your computer, which then replicates itself and sends, oftentimes the typical one is set to make, say, 10 copies of itself and send it to 10 other people on your list, and then 100 copies and send it to 100 people on your list. When I get an email from someone with just a link, I will always write back and say, did you send this? I don't open anything that I don't know. And if I send a link, I always send it with a message saying, this is from Larry, it's safe, something that they wouldn't put on there. First worm was interesting. Robert Morris, a student at Cornell back in the 80s, wanted to use a worm to just crawl around and see how many computers were connected to the internet at that point. Unfortunately, his worm had a bug in it and literally crashed computers, because what it did is it made multiple copies, and each copy made multiple copies, and each copy made multiple copies, and eventually it made so many copies on your computer that your computer wouldn't work anymore. There are bots and botnets. Bots are single infected computers, so it might have a worm, and you'll see later it could have a virus, it could have a Trojan horse. There's lots of things it can have. A botnet is a network of infected computers, and these are done to spread different kinds of things. Malware, which is software that's going to damage your computer. Ransomware, I've had ransomware before, where basically they take over your computer and they say, give us your credit card, we're going to charge $300, and then we'll give you back control of your computer, which then they don't do. There's spam, which is just continually hitting you with messages. And then there's phishing, which, as we've talked about before, is trying to find specific user information, like passwords, things like that. Botnets can be used for all sorts of purposes: stealing data, attacking the infected device, sending spam in your name. Oftentimes you'll get an email, or I get emails from somebody I know, and it's clearly spam. Click here for something fun. And I know it's spam, and I know it came because the person whose computer sent it has the virus or the worm or whatever, the bot, on there. And then denial of service attack is a relatively new thing over the last half a decade, where basically you just keep sending more and more and more messages and clogging up someone's website so that it's dysfunctional. It happens to newspapers all the time. It happens to all sorts of websites. So here's a good, really good video that tells you the differences between these different kinds of malware.
Viruses, worms, trojans, and bots are all part of a class of software called malware. The overwhelming majority of malware is created to make money illegally, often by stealing sensitive and confidential information from victims' computers and mobile devices. Malware can also be used for cyber vandalism, cyber espionage, hacktivism, cyber warfare, and various other reasons. Malware can make entry onto your computer via questionable file downloads, visiting infected websites, or through email containing a seemingly benign link or attachment. Common types of malware. Viruses. Almost all viruses are attached to an executable file, which means the virus may exist on a system but will not spread until a user opens the infected program. Viruses often originate on the internet and spread when downloading a file infected with a virus, peer-to-peer file sharing, or email attachment. Trojan. A Trojan is a harmful piece of software that looks legitimate. Users are typically tricked into leading and executing it on their systems. Trojans can not only steal your sensitive data, they can also give cyber crooks access to your system. Trojans are employed to gain access to your computer's financial and personal information. Ransomware. Ransomware holds your PC hostage and demands money. It locks up your computer, threatening to destroy data, demanding ransom or a payment for release of your data, files, or to regain the ability to use your computer again. Spyware. Spyware secretly gathers private information about the user activity, such as internet usage, and logs keystrokes via the process of keylogging to steal passwords and other sensitive data. Worms. Worms can replicate themselves and infect multiple computers on a network, causing major damage. Network worms often use computer networks to spread, slowing down traffic and relying on security failures such as outdated operating systems and no antivirus programs installed. In contrast, viruses require the spreading of an infected host file. Worms are a standalone software and do not require a host or human help to spread. The best way to protect your system from malware is to keep your operating system clean by downloading regular patches, updates, and making sure that your computer is protected by the latest antivirus software from a trusted vendor.
Now, I do want to point out that that's put out by Kaspersky Labs, which are one of the giants in the virus protection business, but also a Russian-owned company. So I recommend that you use it with caution. There's scuttlebutt around Kaspersky Labs that when you load their software on there, you're really loading viruses and worms and everything on there. They just don't unleash them unless they need them. So anyway, let's go back to the PowerPoint. And the last thing I want to talk about is called social engineering. And this is where you manipulate people to do something, to click on a link, to send you information. The most famous one is the I love you one. If you got a message that was from somebody you knew and said, I love you, please click here, wouldn't you do it? Click here to see my love for you. A lot of people fell for that virus and it spread like crazy. It's usually email from somebody you know. Oftentimes it's a website you use, so you'll get a message that you think is from your bank, and it says, there's a problem with your account, please log in here, and they'll have copied all of the images that are used from the bank so that it looks exactly like an email from your bank. They'll even have the disclaimers on the bottom. The one thing to look for in all of these is they usually have, if they write any text at all, there's misspellings and there's poor grammar, and a bank or any organization would never do that. There's a typical one that asks you to donate to a charity. They give you a sad sex story about somebody. They say, click here to donate money. They even, ones that help out a friend in need. It was interesting. This one was going around a lot a couple years ago, where somebody would write, a friend would write you, wasn't from their account, but they would, their account was hijacked, would say something on the order of, I'm traveling right now and my wallet was stolen. Can you wire me some money? I'll get pay you back when I get home. And then of course the money would be wired to somebody who wasn't that friend. And then posing as a boss, this happened from our campus president. He got hacked, and I got an email one day that was from President Parham. Turned out if I'd looked carefully, I would have noticed it wasn't his email address. And it said, are you around? I need somebody to get something from my office. Can you click here and I'll give you more information? And it was social engineering, again, trying to use the social relationship between my president and myself to get me to do something. And you've read this before, but this is Kubeface, which was a message designed to trick users called Secret Video by Tom. Tom Anderson was the guy who created MySpace. The email was sent to all the MySpace users asking them to download an update for their Flash player, and that installed the Kubeface worm that infected computers. And basically it infected somewhere around 400 to 800,000, but closer to 1 million PCs worldwide. So last video we're gonna watch is how easy it is to break into your cell phone account using social engineering.
So I invited a few of the world's best hackers to try to hack me and show me where my vulnerabilities are. And now I'm gonna meet them in Las Vegas for DEF CON, the biggest hacker convention of the year.
They're gonna hack me using social engineering, which is essentially hacking without any code. They just use a phone and an internet connection.
Do you want to do a sample phishing call?
What's phishing?
Phishing is voice elicitation, and basically what you do is you use the phone to extract information or data points that can be used in a later attack.
Let's do it. Who are you going to call?
Maybe I'll call your cell phone provider and see if I can get them to give me your email address.
I bet they're good. I bet they have my back. But yeah, go for it.
I'm going to spoof from your number, so it's going to look like it's calling from you.
Okay.
Hi, I'm so sorry. Can you hear me okay? I'm sorry. my husband's like, we're about to apply for a loan, and we just had a baby, and he's like, get this done by today, so I'm so sorry. I can't call you back. I'm trying to log into our account for uses information, and I can't remember what email address we used to log the account. The baby's crying, and can you help me? Awesome.
In just 30 seconds,
at gmail.com,
Jessica gets access to my personal email address.
Now, if I needed to add our older daughter on our account so she could call in and make changes, how would I need to go about doing that? You would have to send me a secure PIN through a text message? Yeah, well, the thing is, I don't think I'll be able to receive a text message if I'm on the phone. Oh, I'm not on there either? So I thought when we got married, he added me to the account.
Jess uses my girlfriend's name and a fake social security number.
5127.
To set up her own personal access to my account.
Wait, I'm sorry, so there's no password on my account right now? Can I set that up?
She even gets the support person to change my password.
Thank you so much for your help today.
So she just basically blocked me out of my own account.
I'll get her fed after this. All right, thank you.
Holy shit. So they just gave you access to my entire cell phone account.
You're gonna have to go on and change your password now because it's Jess, my name.
And all it took was a crying baby and a phone call.
Yeah.
Isn't social engineering interesting? I don't recommend you try that, but I thought you would enjoy that video. So we're gonna finish a few minutes early today. Again, a reminder, just a reminder, reaction paper 3, you should be dead center in the middle of your 3 weeks of using strategies to change things on your phone or to change your nighttime routine to make yourself change and be healthier. You'll get the reaction papers due the 25th. I may extend that through the weekend so you have a little bit more time. I'll let you know by announcement and email both. To let you know if I decide to extend that. And then the last reaction paper will be coming out shortly thereafter. If you have questions about your tests or any questions about anything at all, again, our office, we are in our office Tuesdays and Thursdays, usually from 9 to 10 and from 2:15 to 3:15. Please check with us first and email both of us, both George and myself, and we'll make sure to double check that we're going to be there and set up an appointment. If you want to go over your test questions, anything you'd like, we're trying to help you. And again, I will send out a spreadsheet today to help today or tomorrow to help you figure out what you need to get on the third exam and the last two reaction papers, and we will be trying to drum up a bunch of extra credit for you. So with that, I will say good day.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.